Who here has heard of the Dairy Dance-Off before? Clap your hands really loud if you've heard of the Dairy Dance-Off before. Come on, let's let these ladies have it. So I'm really excited today to introduce the people that are behind the Dairy Dance-Off. But before I do, I just want to introduce myself. So I'm Josh Hushin. I'm with Cargill. And Cargill's really proud to sponsor this session today. Cargill's all about feeding the dreams of our customers. And whether those dreams are something to do with a transition to a robotic dairy, maybe a different component income for your dairy herd, or a calf and heifer program, Cargill's uniquely positioned to help feed the dreams of our customers. And if you have interest in more information about Cargill, our booth is right over there, so please stop by. For some of the dreams of our customers, it's about becoming social media stars and changing the way that dairy farmers advocate online. And I'm proud to say that both Katie and Jess are both customers of Cargill as well, which is why we're excited to sponsor their session today and help them share some more of their dreams. Jess is a fifth generation dairy farmer from Pennsylvania, a Spruce Row Farm in the northwestern part of the state. And she has her mom, Janet, here with her today as well. And Katie is a third generation dairy farmer from Pennsylvania, turned first generation dairy farmer in Maryland at Cow Comfort in Dairy. Both of them have a unique perspective on telling the dairy story online, and I'm excited to let them share that with you today. So let's give them a round of applause.
Thank you for that. And we'd like to thank Cargill for sponsoring us. We really appreciate it. Well, we're gonna dive right in. We're not entirely sure we're qualified to do this, but here we are. Thank you for having us. I'm Jess.
I'm Katie.
And this is the Jess and Katie Show.
More to come later.
So Josh's introduction was very thorough, and we appreciate it, but we actually think you might have missed a few things. For starters, Katie loves palm trees.
Love them.
Like, she's got photos, paintings, stickers, string art.
Madison's kind of let me down in that department right now.
Yeah.
Just saying. Jess loves gummy bears. This picture here, that's actually a 5-pound package of gummy bears.
Hey, that was a gift from another gummy bear lover.
Who's also a dairy farmer.
P.S. Redder the best.
The love runs deep. Love runs deep.
If you know Katie, you know, she's not so much a crazy cat lady, except for one cat. Mr. Mittens is a giant yellow cat who desperately hates Snapchat.
He hates it, but he's an awesome cat.
So much growling.
He has six toes, hence the name Mr. Mittens. So when you get a phone call from friends, they probably don't usually sing, like, but this one does. Every time, sometimes when she calls, she just sings. And so she has this obsession with Disney movies and especially Disney songs. So
I may or may not have written a parody Disney song for this conference that Katie wouldn't let me sing.
No,
so
we
find me
that
after if you want to hear it.
Scratch that.
Katie, aside from being a dairy farmer, is also a Spanish teacher.
Somebody's got to make some money.
Yeah.
I'm just saying.
She teaches Spanish to middle schoolers part-time at home, and she's actually also doing an online Spanish teacher for dairy women right now.
Tailored for the dairy industry, so all farm vocab.
And the header in her email actually is in Spanish.
Everything's
she's
in Spanish.
She's kind of weird
ass
about it. Yeah.
Jess, if you didn't know, is also an author. If you have not seen her book, it's on Amazon. You can get it there, too. But this is, I mean, we just said about songs, right? So this is full of nursery songs that she actually wrote to the tune of nursery songs. It features her farm. It's a really great book. Kids and adults of all ages love it.
I may sing them in my head a lot. There's always music just going on up there. So one of the things that really bonded Katie and I, there are a lot of them, but jerseys. Sorry, not sorry. We like all cows. Yeah, don't bring your weak other breed crap up in here. You can, if you're going to throw things at us, please wait till the end of the presentation. But our love for jerseys runs deep. It may or may not be why Katie married her husband. A little
kinda,
bit. Not completely.
I mean,
just
we do have jerseys. I
just
mean,
a little.
He had jerseys when I met him, so I'm like, hey. And then we have dinosaurs. And people have been asking us, okay, why are you wearing a dinosaur pin? Why do you have stuffed dinosaurs? Well, that is going to be kicking off our presentation because I don't know about you, so most of you, if you're a farmer in here, maybe one of your top questions when you meet another farmer is, hey, how many cows do you milk? How many acres do you have? How big's your farm? How many generations? Why are we not asking fun questions? So you're going to learn throughout this. Our theme is to have fun because we need to change the way we're talking to people. So why not ask, what's your favorite dinosaur?
So once you all in your life, you all knew what your favorite dinosaur was.
Yeah, so I want you guys all to take a minute and think about what your favorite dinosaur is. I'm serious. I know it's been since third grade, but what is your favorite dinosaur? Jess, what's your favorite dinosaur?
I prefer the Stegosaurus. These ridiculous plates and their tails, they're like the most badass dinosaur, for sure.
Well, My favorite is, it's a toss-up between the brontosaurus slash brachiosaurus. I just love them because they're gentle giants.
They are
and
super cool.
They're kind of like cows in that
I'll give you
sense.
That. Gentle giants.
So we're starting this off by telling, give you tips and tricks of how to tell your story.
It's not really rocket scientists. Be real, be honest, and be yourself. Katie and I are very similar people, we found, except for that she hates peanut butter, which I think is un-American.
Sorry.
But other than that, but we still tell our stories completely differently. And no matter how you tell your story, even if it's the same story I'm telling, you're going to resonate with an audience that I'm not. For example, our friend Renee, who blogs at Eat Farm Love, we are not parents. We don't have kids. Renee does. She's a mom. So in that mommy blogger world, she can relate to those people better than we can a lot of times. For example, this post she made a few weeks ago, I really loved. It talked about how her kids are sick all winter long because kids and germs, just like, it's the perfect marriage. And she talked about how her kids were on medicine to feel better from ear infections. Well, and then she talked about how we do the same thing with our cows. We want to keep them healthy. So we give them medicine when they need it as well. There's another example. Tyler Ribeiro in California started a page called Dairy Dad not long ago. He does the same thing. He talks, you know, some about his kids, some about the farm, and he's reaching an audience that Katie and I may never reach. And we need to all tell our stories a little differently. And Derek Josie, Tillamook Dairy Farmer, I don't know how many of you follow him. He tells his story differently than anyone else. He does it very snarkily. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's a word, but and sarcastically. And when we deal with hateful vegans or activists online, block and delete is our method.
It's actually a very fun game.
You don't need that negativity right in your life. Derek attacks them. He kind of throws their words back at them. And I think his goal in life is to be deleted and blocked by them. And he does it very well. And there are so many other people telling their stories in completely different ways. And I think all of our voices are a little bit different. And the more we get out there, the more we'll relate to other people.
So ask for help if you need it. So Jess and I, we have been through this so many times. We've been attacked, and we're not, you know, proud to say
that. We're still here.
Yeah, we're still here. The death threats, guys, they're whatever. We've heard so many of them.
So many death threats.
We've been called so many different names. Like, our skin is super thick. Like, it just happens after a while.
The first one gets you. I will give it to you. Yes. The first attack really hits you hard. I think I drank chocolate milk and ate toast on my couch for 4 days after the first attack. But you do learn to get over it.
But definitely ask for help if you need it. So reach out to Jess, reach out to me, reach out to any advocates out there that are doing the same thing. We're all in this together, and we're all there to help you. Another place that you can find help is actually Checkoff. I know not everybody's like super happy with Checkoff right now, but our regional Checkoff, American Dairy Association Northeast, I'm going to give a shout out to Emma because she is one of our friends and works there. And she has this program called Dairy Fan, and it's an online forum for dairy farmers. If we're having technical issues, if we're having a problem with, you know, activists attacking us, maybe it's just a tip and trick on how to post a video the right way. They're there to help. Also, DMI. DMI is the national checkoff, and I don't know if you know this, but they have been collecting what they call their banned words list.
Don't
for
read
years.
The list.
Do not
don't read it.
Like,
worst
if you,
words ever.
If you're very offended by like the word damn, don't. Just don't. Cool. There are words on there. I'm like, that's a thing? I didn't know that. Okay.
Awful.
So just copy and paste it. So we're telling you this because when you have a business page, your reach is obviously a lot more. So you copy and paste those banned words in there. So if some idiot goes on your page to post something awful, it will not publish it. Only you can see it and that person can see it, but nobody else can see that post. And then you can just go and ban and delete them, which, again, is a really, really fun game. So don't fear the hateful vegans. This is one of the number one things that we hear from dairy farmers, like, oh, I don't want to do a page because I don't want to get attacked. It's going to happen. People don't like the way we do things, and people are very, very brave behind a computer screen. But don't fear them because, honestly, we get death threats, and it's not a big deal anymore. We're still here.
And the first time it happened to both of us, I will say, before I even knew what was happening, some of the bigger advocates who have been doing it longer, and I know DMI contacted me, Animal Ag Alliance contacted me to help guide me in what to do. So you're not alone in this. You know. And as far as finding your support system, I know this summer Katie lost a cow, and she kind of started her journey. You know, you start the journey thinking, well, maybe she'll get better, and this is a teaching moment, and, you know, sometimes they just don't.
She had Klebsiella, and we always fight it every year. And Autumn was, I had documented her life to people. And so I was documenting this. I got a float tank for her and everything. I put a lot of work into this cow. And so, unfortunately, she didn't make it. And I'm like, okay, well, I got to let my followers know this. How am I going to do this? So I texted Jess, and a phone call later, I had a post written out. People, I think that we just, you know, put the stuff out there, and it's instantaneous. It's not. It took me a full day to write that post and really, okay, how are my followers, the people that don't do what I do every day, how are they going to resonate with this? How are they going to connect with this?
And sometimes you just need help finding those words.
Yes.
Like,
so Kate don't be afraid to reach out.
Yeah, don't be afraid to reach out. One other way to help tell your story, a cool way, is to collaborate with other influencers. We have this kind of thing. Katie, you don't have to take it quite to the level Katie and I have. We're going to talk about a project here at the end of the presentation that, yeah, just rein it in. She's been telling everyone she sees, and I'm like, maybe a little mystery here before we debut it. But, for example, about a month ago, we were locked in this battle on Instagram for Tongue Out Tuesday. I don't know if you guys follow hashtag Tongue Out Tuesday. Basically, it's pictures of cows with their tongues out. This is a brown Swiss calf. This is from Becca Hilby. She's from right here in Wisconsin. She and another Instagrammer very misguidingly thought that Holsteins and brown Swiss could beat Jerseys at the Tongue Out Tuesday Challenge.
They cannot.
Yeah, that lapse in judgment aside, they're great people to follow. But once Katie, Derek, Josie, and I got a hold of that, I think it was pretty clear that Jerseys won that battle. And now we're to the point where I only know it's Tuesday when I'm tagged in about 1,000 posts on Instagram for Tongue Out Tuesday. But our followers, you get followers from each other because you're tagging each other in posts, and our followers love watching us interact. They love watching the sarcasm, the funny digs, and I gotta say, I think the real mic drop was when about 5 or 6 years ago, the Jersey tongue wiggle, I guess, I don't know, got my brother and I on America's Funniest Home Videos. So I obviously had to dig that video up and repost it, and just boom, is all I gotta say. So we kind of tailored this presentation not to just the farmers. We knew there'd be a lot of industry professionals here. And you guys, there are ways you can help us tell our story. One way is, I'm not going to lie to you, sometimes you can get burnt out doing this. You feel like you've posted all the posts, and it just feels like you're preaching to the choir. Like, you're only reaching other ag people, and that's not who I'm trying to reach. And is anyone listening? I mean, you know some people are listening, but sometimes it just feels like, is anyone listening? The last few months, I know I've been posting as regularly because of that. And sometimes just the acknowledgement can help us feel like, you know what, I see what you're doing. I appreciate what you're doing. Just a thanks or just encouragement to keep doing it. One big way is if you're part of your company's social media is to share our posts. It kind of gives us, without actually you saying it, it gives us like a pat on the back, like you're going in the right direction. And one great example of that was when we talked about, when we did the Dairy Dance-Off, which we're going to talk about a little bit later. Don Schindler, actually, from DMI, saw it immediately, and he thought, this is going to be huge. Can we compile all these videos and put them on a website for you? And we're like, yes, because we don't know how to do that for ourselves. And they did that, and it was just a way for Katie and I to be like, look, we did something cool here. We did something good. And, you know, you don't want to be that needy person, but everyone needs encouragement every once in a while.
There's also three resources us farmers are always short on. Time, technology, and money.
She forgot because we don't have any. Oh, farm life.
Yes. Technology, time, and money. That is what we don't have. And a good example of industry helping us out with that is, so we ship our milk to Land O'Lakes. If you have not seen the SHE-IO video, I think you're living under a rock.
Watch this. This is
the old McDonald like remix. And so this is my sister and my two cousins. This is my family farm. My family farm is in central Pennsylvania. And Land O'Lakes reached out to them. I actually did a commercial with Land O'Lakes last year about women in ag. And they took this mainstream. They aired this music video during The Voice.
The Voice.
Okay. Yeah. So what we're saying here is, like, you don't have to be Land O'Lakes. I know not every company has, you know, money like that. But come on, reach out to us. We have ideas. But again, we're short on the time, the technology, and the money. So any help that you can give us to get that message out there would be really appreciated.
And the cool thing about this video was I shared it immediately. I feel like you know my love of singing and music. And a lot of friends from high school who have nothing to do with agriculture now, just follow my page, a lot of women commented and was like, I'm not a farmer and I know nothing about what's going on in this video, but it just felt awesome to watch this and to empower them. I think they rolled it out around International Women's Day. It was kind of around that, but I loved this. If you haven't seen it, you should look it up. Oh, missed one. So the content you post, you can literally post about anything. I know some organizations will tell you not to post about the bad of farming, but if everything's always glitter and rainbows, no one's going to believe what you're saying. Everybody knows that life is not perfect. So you can't just post about the perfect. So one of our biggest things is to be natural, not staged. Now, obviously, a few of these photos are staged, but we literally scoured our archives to find professionally taken photos of us.
We don't have
any.
And
they just don't exist. We're not against professionally taken photos. Obviously, you're going to have to take them. You're going to share them. But they shouldn't be predominantly what you post. People want to see your real life. You know, for example, well, all of these are staged except that one. She's eating ice cream. I don't know what I'm doing.
This is an outtake from the project that we're going to hint at a little bit later that I'm really excited about.
But, you know, this is my brother in the top center here. And he was petting that cow. I said, hey, look at me. And they both did. And that's where that photo came from. You know, staged is not a problem, but you also need to do it naturally.
I also get a lot of comments of, wow, I wish I was that clean in the barn. Guess what? Those are my barn clothes, and there's manure stains all over them. You just can't see them. And I was not posing, and we were doing a cow pie bingo there with my cow Snickerdoodle, and I just happened to, I mean, jerseys are the best to take pictures with because they always have their ears forward because they're curious about everything. And yeah,
but they're bad at selfies, worst at selfies.
Yeah. But I do put tiaras on my cow because she deserved it.
Katie and I do a lot of videos, and videos are obviously somewhat staged. When you go into a video, you know what you're going to say, but there are so many outtakes from videos.
And sometimes you just got to post them because they're funny.
And one of the comments I get most, almost more than any, is how relatable I am. Social media is not meant for perfection. I'm a little bit like, relatable, is that like a synonym for ugly and weird? But it's okay, I take it as a compliment. But you can't be afraid to post the outtakes.
Replay is one of my friendly. Oh, gross.
Call PA her home.
Here's the story about another farmer who milked cows to their dying.
Beep.
You told me the wrong thing.
Stop.
You told me the wrong thing.
I did not.
Who milked cows with her guy in Maryland?
Oh, who milked Jersey?
Rest right? Is history, or so they say.
Oh my gosh.
I forgot the words. We want to help to find a way, so here we are. Lollipop, lollipop, lolly, 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 lollipop, lollipop, lolly, 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 lollipop. Ba-dum, bum, bum.
I might cuss like a sailor, so I'm really, really trying this morning.
When you post the outtakes in the silly videos like that, it brings in an audience because it's fun, it's entertaining, and then they stick around for the posts that are three paragraphs long about why I use antibiotics on my cows. We're trying to build relationships here. I hate the phrase, we both do, educating the consumer. Nobody wants to be preached to. So by sharing silly, stupid videos like this, they're gonna stick around for the long haul. And that was like, we had a real hard time choosing which videos to post.
I still can't not laugh when I watch those. So again, rehearse versus stage. So this photo up here, this is my husband. And yes, we did stage this. We were doing a national breakfast campaign, actually, for Chekhov. And so obviously you cannot tell cows where to stand. They don't listen very well. And no, he does not walk around the farm with a glass of milk. It's usually a mug of coffee. This was staged. But as you can see, he's got his barn clothes on. I asked him to stop preg checking for like 5 minutes, which he grumbled about. But this post went pretty big. People absolutely loved it. And by the way, just a little hint, when you're posting pictures about cows, always put a human in there. People just go nuts over that because people that have never been on a farm and never been close to a cow, they're scared to death of them. And this tells you right now, one, we don't abuse our cows. Two, they're pretty comfortable around us. And then, of course, we have this fun picture. We have a lot of outtakes in here, actually, for this big project we're dropping on Sunday.
Dropping some beats.
Yeah, the project that we were working on, which it's really
just
hard
rain,
for me
rain
not
it
to
and
tell
it.
You.
Give it 10 minutes. We'll at the end.
I can't, okay. We wanted this to be a little bit more professional. So that's why we actually did a recording session for what we're dropping on Sunday.
When you're talking about some of the hard topics, like GMOs, antibiotic resistance, animal welfare, you need to rehearse those. You know, there are times, every post I make on my Facebook page, I write it out on the notepad in my iPhone first. And then I reread it two or three times before I actually post it. One, I want to make sure I didn't misspell words because autocorrect is my enemy. And two, I want to make sure the exact point I want to get across is coming across in the way I want it to come across. So rehearsing is not a bad thing. Especially some of the videos we've done have been a little bit more serious. And you'll see in this, Katie has clipboards, notepads, or note cards. I've done a few videos where I've written bullet points on my hand. Because we do a ton of videos, guys, and yet every time I hit record, my mind goes blank and my heart's in my throat. Nobody loves watching themselves on video.
But we do video because that's the biggest draw for people.
People
love
videos.
That is why we do videos. And do not make them very long. 2 minutes is about tops.
And these are some examples of videos that we did a little bit of rehearsing with.
Feed for my cows for all 500. Okay, so you got 350 milking, you got all the young stock and dry cows and everything. $75,000 a month.
Two, maybe you didn't kill the bacteria. It might still be there just weak. You're causing it to become resistant to that antibiotic, which means the next time you have a sinus infection, that antibiotic might not work.
So what are GMOs? And I came up with an acronym so you can remember these, okay? So the acronym is CAPS, C-A-P-S.
Billie Jean is leaving today. She's gonna go to auction. She will probably be sold for beef and she will be butchered and eaten. It's the bad part of our business.
I don't know if anybody has seen, if you follow me, you might have seen the calf warming video that I did on Sunday. So we have a calf warmer. We are not as cold as here, but it was still cold. And I was showing, I wanted to do a video about, you know, it's snowing, it's crappy out, but this is why, how we take care of our calves. Because I had volunteered at our calving corner, and the biggest question I got is, why do you separate cows and calves? So I'm like, you know what, I obviously need to address this topic. So before I did that, though, I mean, I was kind of crazy going back and forth feeding calves, vaccinating cows, and I made time to sit down and write out my bullet points of what I wanted to say before I did that video. And that video is, I think, like 2 minutes. But I made sure all my points were across. So that's our point as far as the serious topics, especially, you need to make sure that what you want to say is already in your head and you're ready to go.
But at the same time, again, staged versus rehearsed, you don't want to read it from a script. The more videos you do, the more you learn that, trust me. So as far as helping influence what we post, collaborations. Tara, the New Mexico milkmaid, actually does this really well. She's grown her Instagram following to... by 5,000 or 6,000 followers just in the last 6 months because she does a lot of product giveaways. She pairs with online boutiques or companies. If you contact influencers and offer products that they can help give away on their posts. And generally what you do is if you want to be involved in the giveaway, you have to like my page, you have to like the company page, then you have to bring friends into it. So not only are you growing your social media following, they're going to continue following and you and start seeing your posts online. It's a great way to help grow your social media, actually. Also, if you see opportunities out in the community, let us know. Sometimes on the Today Show at 8 a.m., they'll have some kind of anti-dairy thing. I don't know about it till 4 p.m. I don't watch the Today Show. I'm milking cows. You know, tell us. We can make social media posts about it. Or if you see something happening in your community where farmers should be represented and aren't, let us know. I mean, time-wise, we may not be able to do anything about it, but maybe we can. If your kid's school is having a fair of some sort, go to a local farmer and offer to help them take a calf there. Even if you don't have any information out, just kids wanting to pet and feed and talk to you about that calf, they'll learn so much. One big one, you know, sending influencers to trainings, and that gets a little hairy, I think, but one platform we're really missing out on is YouTube in a big way. People use YouTube for everything.
Like makeup tutorials,
product reviews. Kids will watch other kids watching movies on YouTube. Mm-hmm. It's ridiculous. And for a lot of us influencers, we've talked about this quite a bit online, actually. You know, Facebook and Instagram are right here. YouTube's a whole new beast. The content you post, the algorithm, the way you post it is really daunting to us. It takes a lot of time to do. You know, maybe sending influencers to YouTube conferences to learning about it or offering to help them manage a YouTube page. I think YouTube is where we need to go, and I know a lot of us are kind of afraid to go there.
Which is also where the time, technology, and money comes in for industry professionals to help us farmers out with that.
Because, I mean, to state it bluntly, if we go down, you're going down with us.
Country.
We're all in this together. Helping us tell our story is going to help everyone.
So along with that, with collaboration, bring us into your campaigns. Guys, listen, the profile frames for your profile picture on Facebook, they're great. But what are they really doing? Are we really communicating the message to consumers? Yeah, I can put a frame around my profile picture that says, I heart cows, I heart dairy, I heart whatever. What is that really doing other than giving me the sense of pride I already have because I know what I do is right? What is that really doing? What is that really communicating to consumers? We need to just, you know, bring us more into your campaigns. Don't make them just farmer focused. Make them consumer based.
Consumers still trust farmers. Mm-hmm. And I think the way to put the message out there is using farmers to do it. We just don't have the time to do it or the resources on our own.
And there may come a day where consumers don't trust us anymore. So let's use that to our advantage now. Biggest takeaway right here, guys, for the industry professionals in the room, we don't want you to tell us what you're doing for us. We already know. We already know that you're making good feed. That's why we buy it from you. We already know that the dip that I'm buying and the milk liners that I'm buying are good. That's why I'm buying it from your company. But what we need you to do is help us tell consumers what we are doing for them. And when I say we, I'm not talking just us farmers. I'm talking about both of us. I'm talking about the farmers and the industry professionals. Do you know how many people, their minds are blown when I tell them that we actually work with a nutritionist, aka a registered dietitian? That is huge. We've got to work together more on this. We already know what you do for us. Thank you so much. But how about you help us get that message out to the consumer in a better and effective way?
I think one great example of that is in the last few years, the animal welfare audits have come about with the farm program. And I know Dean's has a stewardship program. We're with Dean's and we were in the region that they first rolled the program out in. And I wasn't afraid of it. I know it made a lot of farmers angry. I knew what we were doing was right and I knew we were doing it well. And the audit reflected that. At the end of the program, he's supposed to come up with some long-term and short-term goals. And he was having trouble reaching for them. And my only concern with the program was that was pushed by processors or companies like Walmart because their consumers want to know the animals are taken care of. Okay, but let's not play defense and wait for them to come at us. Let's play offense. Go to those farms. Find a way to put it out there that, look, you wanted this, we did it, and our farmers are doing it right. And that I think that is, we need to stop. As an industry, we're very conservative. And we kind of sit back and wait for opportunities and those kind of comments to come to us. I think we need to start pushing back. So I know the video's sideways here. It's going to flip when we're done. The Dairy Dance Off.
How many of you guys have heard of the Dairy Dance Off? How many participated in the Dairy Dance Off? Really?
Well, I'm
yes,
set.
Jana. Thank
yeah,
you.
Jana,
thank
done
you.
Front row.
If you have not heard about the Dairy Dance Off, you are living under a rock. Sorry, not sorry for telling you that. So this started in my calf barn, which, by the way, is nicer than my house.
And probably warmer.
It is way warmer than my house, too. This was in the middle of, I don't even remember, March.
March, I think.
It was cold. I had my coveralls on. I was scrubbing calf dividers. So we have the poly calf dividers. And I'm in there scrubbing them. And I'm kind of well known for, I love to dance. I love to dance.
She's got moves.
I do. You cannot be a Spanish teacher and not have some awesome Latin dance moves. You can see me afterwards for that. No, I'm kidding.
She's not kidding.
So I always have a Bluetooth speaker with me anywhere I go in the barn. My husband's not a huge fan of it, but whatever. So one of my favorite songs came on, which is Havana by Camila Cabello. You know the song Havana?
Ooh, na, na.
Okay, you need to look it up if you don't.
We'll sing it later for you.
Yes. So I am kind of famous for the moves to that. And so I Snapchatted it to a leadership program that I was a part of then. And I was like, you know what? I'm just going to post this to Facebook and Insta because if it makes somebody else laugh, especially a farmer, because we were all, you know, super depressed, then it was totally worth 20 seconds of my time to make a complete fool out of myself. So I did.
As soon as I saw that post, I was like, oh, no, she didn't post a dance video of her in her barn and think I wasn't going to take that as a dance battle challenge. So in true Jess Peters fashion, I got my brother Cole to dance the Carlton, you know, the Carlton to the song, It's Not Unusual
it was
to Be
awful.
Loved by Anyone. It was bad.
I totally
His moves
won.
Improved. You'll see in a minute. And the second I pressed send to post that to Facebook, I thought, holy crap, this is going to be a thing. I texted Katie a few texts, a few phone calls, and the Dairy Dance Off was born. This video will turn. In case you missed the Dairy Dance Off, this is a snippet of the original video we put. Guys, we know dairy farming sucks right now.
Yeah, it does, but you know what doesn't? Epic dance parties.
So find your favorite song and crank it up.
Bust a move, or you can epically lip sync if you want.
Then film it.
Then post it all over social media using the hashtag DairyDanceOff.
add a couple sentences about why you love dairy farming?
Challenge or tag a friend to do the same thing, and let's make this epic.
Let's show the world how fun dairy farmers can be.
Right, cutie? Shake, shake. Yeah.
That was my brother dancing in the parlor, so his moves improved a little bit.
So many videos. Guys, we lost count of how many videos came across our feed. People from ages 0 up to 80 participated
farmers,
in this.
Farmers, creameries,
universities,
organizations,
farm credit.
Oh my gosh, so many videos.
And it did not discriminate. So farms from 30 cows up to 5, 6,000 cows participated in this. It was amazing. We were also a global sensation. Did not see that coming. So this started out nationwide, and then it went across the pond. It went to Germany. It went to Ireland.
Scotland.
Scotland.
Pip, pip, cheerio,
yes,
England.
It was crazy. And I think the best part for us with this was we were getting messages, direct messages from farmers we have never met, we'll probably never meet. And they just said, you know what, thank you so much for doing this because I haven't laughed or smiled like that for at least 6 months. So that gave us, like, you know what, if this is all that's doing, because did this solve milk price? No. Are we still poor? Yes. It didn't fix anything, but for at least a month, it gave somebody something to look forward to. And even now, you know, when I'm waiting for a load of feed to mix or a slow milker or whatever, I'm still bust a move because it still makes me feel better.
Who hasn't sang into a bottle brush? Come on, be real.
So there was millions of views. I mean, we lost count. I think Chekhov lost count because they were helping us compile all the videos. And this is the Wright sisters from New York. Their post alone was over 30 million views.
It went viral.
It was amazing.
They lip sang to Don't Stop Believing in their kefir barn into pitchforks, which I may or may not have done last week. Don't judge me. But thanks to them, they pushed it even further. We were doing radio interviews. We did magazine interviews from reporters from Ireland. Mm-hmm. They just really pushed it over the top.
Which was great because a lot of people, like it was shocking to us that a lot of people didn't realize how much we were struggling as dairy farmers. And so when we did these interviews, they're like, oh, we had no idea. And I'm like, yeah, no kidding. You're not less than 2% of the population here.
We were so tired of what was being reported in the mainstream media of farmer suicide rates and mental health awareness. And those are things we need to be talking about. But this was an amazing, positive way to bring that into the mainstream without being depressing about it. It was just so much fun.
It was.
Maybe we should do a round two. So the point, what's our point? I have this system called the 50-50 theory, and I literally just had to name it for this presentation, so there's probably a better name out there, but if 50% of this room cares what I have to say, you're gonna listen to me no matter how I say it. If this half of the room doesn't, and I make it fun and entertaining, you're still gonna listen, and you're gonna learn something. Even if it's one tiny little tidbit, you're gonna walk away having learned something from what I said. We have to make this fun. It's kind of our life motto. If you make it entertaining, we are millennials up here.
And I'm shame.
Yeah, very much a millennial in the sense that I like shiny things. I tell Katie this all the time. And when I say shiny, I mean distracting. Sometimes they're actually shiny. My focus is pulled constantly. I know that. I'm not proud of it, but I know it. And I tell Katie this all the time. I think she's probably not offended anymore. But before I knew her really well, I watched an interview. And you know, when you're watching videos and you see someone you know in it, usually it draws your focus a little bit more. And I thought, oh, I kind of know her. She's pretty cool. It was a 2-minute long video, which isn't that long, of her talking to the camera about how she takes care of her cows. I got through 30 seconds of it and I was like, next. I know her. I knew her at that time. And I knew what she was saying and wanted to hear it. But if you can't keep my attention, the millennial farmer, for 30 seconds, you're not going to keep anyone we want to like put that out to for 10 seconds.
And to be fair, that was a TV crew that came out to my farm to interview me. So I really had no choice but to just talk to the camera. They only panned on the cows for like 10 seconds. But that taught me, too, as an influencer, you know what? This isn't going to go far with consumers. So when I do a lot of live Facebook Live videos because that brings the most draw with people. And the interaction, guys, is ridiculous. I have people messaging me at least 2-3 times a week just because they have a question about dairy. I have a hashtag that I use a lot. It's called Ask Farmers Not Google, coming to merchandise near you soon. Yeah, it is on my cup. I use it a lot because I'm so sick of people going to Dr. Oz or to celebrities to get their information from people that have never stepped foot on a dairy farm before. So it has taught me with these live videos, you know, you need to move around, you need to make it interactive. And if you take nothing away from this presentation, it's you got to make it fun. You have to make it engaging.
And if you make it fun and you share your life with your audience, we're building relationships here. And sometimes I'll make a post and I'll think it's a really good post. I put some thought and time into it. It'll get like 20 likes. And that's not very many for me. And I'm like, wonderful. Nobody saw this. Well, then a month later, a friend from high school who doesn't know anything about dairy will say, hey, I saw this thing on TV, but then I saw this post you made a month ago, and I wanted to know your opinion. Because I'm building relationships. Nobody wants to be preached to. They want to talk to someone they trust. So by sharing these fun, stupid, silly things, you're building a relationship, and people are getting to know you, and then they're going to bring you those tough questions.
So with that, before we get to this part, if you don't follow us already, please follow Spruce Row Farms and Cow Comfort in Dairy. And you're going to want to follow us because this big project we're dropping on Sunday, and I'm so excited. I can't hold it in. I can't.
I'm not going to let her tell you exactly what it is. We're working on giving the Peterson Farm Brothers a run for their money. It's a project we've been working on for a while. And we do have some handouts, some do's and don'ts of social media, tried and true. We have made so many mistakes. And this is the culmination of those mistakes. We know what to do and what not to do. And also on the back is our contact information. Always feel free to contact us.
Yes.
Sometimes we're busy, and I do this thing where I'll open my email or a message and read it in the barn, but I don't have enough service to respond, and I'll forget for forever. Don't feel bad hounding me.
And people, I just actually had to post a thing last week. I am very busy. I teach part-time because, again, somebody has to bring in health insurance and money. So I do that till noon, then I'm in the barn all afternoon, and then I do teach an online Spanish course for the dairy industry. I am very busy, but I'm never busy to help another person. I love helping people. So
we're doing this because we love this industry.
And the more people we have to do this with us, the bigger voice that we can have. We are less than 2% of the population, guys, and we need to have that voice big, and we need to have it stretch a lot of places.
So thank you for having us. I hope this was beneficial.
Thank you, Cargo, again, for sponsoring us,
so
giving
much.
Us amazing opportunity. And are there any questions that we can answer for you out there? I'm going to repeat the question. So the question was, do we use any specific type of computer software, video software, to put our videos together? I'm going to let Jess answer about the editing part of that.
I do some edited videos. I use a software. I mean, you can use any software. The software I use is called Power Director, just because that's what I know. And sometimes I YouTube how to work it. Speaking of YouTube. But I do some edited together. And like the video we're going to release on Sunday is edited together. I don't know if any of you watched. I did a video back in August called Struggling Farmer. It was a very emotional. It was a very serious video. And I had to edit that together because it was really hard for me to get through. It was talking about how you feel as a dairy farmer and the isolation and the struggle we're going through right now. But a lot of the videos we do just out on the farm that are, you know, just a minute or 2 minutes long are just continuous. But I have dabbled in edited videoing, and it's really hard to do because even, you know, like Josh was asking me yesterday, our 2 or 3 minute long video can take like 5 to 6 hours to edit. It's not hard. It just takes a lot of time, and I guarantee someone who knows what they're doing could do it in less time, but I do a little bit of editing.
So when we
and
do collab-
been very well received.
Yeah, when we do collaboration, Jess is always the editor, and that's why I just stick to live videos, but those can be problematic too, because there was one time that I was actually live videoing our veterinarian had come to do an LDA surgery, and it did not go well. So, but what I mean by that is, there were some technical difficulties, but when you're doing it live, anybody and everybody can tune in and see it, right? The cool thing with Facebook is once it's done and you hit end, you can take that off. Like, it doesn't have to stay on
there.
We
have both made videos, like, put them up, watched them, and been like, oh, crap, and deleted them. Like,
and there's nothing wrong with that.
No, there is not. Mistakes are often made.
Any other questions? Yes. Yes. Yeah. And
your recommendations
Well, with jerseys, it's hard because I'll walk through our pre-fresh, nobody's cabin. You walk through 10 minutes later, well, where'd you come from? You know, they cough and they come
out. They also all cab in the middle of the night. Ours I'm not don't. That dedicated to my social media. I need sleep.
No, live videos, I do them a lot when I have really good service at the farm, too. And I really have felt that that brings the most followers in. But when you are doing live, anytime I do live, I am definitely making bullet points of what I want to say. And my husband helped me with this last one with the calf warmer, which was really good because that was, you know, I knew that there was a big potential to be getting attacked because a lot of people, that's the number one thing we get is, oh, you take calves away from their mom, you rip them away, blah, blah, blah. And that's, I can kind of be a little sassy. So when you watch that video at the end, I go, hey, Dave, can you hear that? And he was like, no, what? And I was like, oh, it's not the mom crying for her calf like the animal activist wants you to believe. She's actually out there with her herd mate. She's hungry. She doesn't care that she just had a calf 4 hours ago. So, live video is, it's very nerve-wracking, and I'm surprised you can't hear my heartbeat through the video sometimes because it's very loud.
Well, and I will say, I have horrible service on my farm, so live videos are hard to do. And live videos are very well perceived. But the videos that I make and just post are also really well received. Video in general is where you need to go. Not all the time. People love videos.
Which is why we need to be on YouTube.
Yes.
Good question. Any other questions? How often do you need to post? So that's a tricky one because like Jess said, we get burnout. Like there, I will tell you, so DMI has done the research on social media, when is the best time to post. The best days to post are Thursdays and Sundays. The reasoning behind that is Thursday, you're getting close to the weekend, so people are looking through their social feeds like, hey, what's going on this weekend? And then Sundays, it's the end of the weekend, getting ready for the work week, and that's kind of like the release to go through social.
I will say, when we released the Dairy Dance Off, it was really funny. She was really pushing to release on a Thursday or Sunday, and I was editing it and also trying to farm, so I was like, you need to give me some time to edit this because with the music, it was tricky. And I was like, Katie, we could release this at 1 a.m. on a Tuesday, and I think it's going to be fine. But I will say the best advice I ever got was actually from a high school friend who's in the horse racing industry, kind of. If you don't feel like posting, don't post because it comes through. Yep. I have done that every once in a while. Like, I just haven't posted in a while. I need to post something. And it just seems like a fluff post. Yeah. And the people who have been following me, I've been doing this for 5 or 6 years now, kind of know something's off. And I mentioned for the last month or two, I haven't been posting as much. I literally have people sending me messages being like, are you okay, Jess? Is everything all right? Because there are months I'll go through and post almost every day. Something happens on your farm that you could post every day. Mm-hmm. But I'd say to keep your audience intrigued and growing, you'd want to post probably at least 3 times a week.
Yeah.
Which and one of those should be a video.
Yeah.
Videos are super uncomfortable. I still don't love doing videos. Nobody likes watching themselves on videos, which people find amazing because I do so many videos. But
and right now we only have like, I have 6,000 followers. She has 6,000 followers, which by the way, just that number does not mean anything. The millions of views, when you have a business page, one of the biggest videos I've done is in our milking parlor. It was a 5-minute, this is how you milk a cow. People had no idea how you milked a cow. Legit, guys, there are people out there that think you still milk cows by hand. That video was amazing, and the last time I looked, it was almost at 1 million views. Not everybody hits the follow button. Not everybody hits the like button. But when you have a business page, you get those really cool insights that you wouldn't get anywhere
else. People are watching.
They are watching.
You, like I said, you'll make a post you think is really good, and you only get a few likes, and you're kind of disappointed. People are watching.
Yeah. Which is usually between 4 p.m. and 8 p.m. at night. Yep, that's you. Yep.
I personally, honestly, I don't really post much after 5 p.m. I just feel like I don't get as much engagement. And we're a little weird. We don't watch the analytics the way a lot of people do this. We're not doing this for money. You know, we're doing this because we love the dairy industry. We're passionate about it, and we want to show people what we're doing. And just what I've learned from watching my posts over the years, if I post after 4 p.m., even like you figure, oh, people will see it the next day, I don't get nearly as much engagement. So I usually try and post before 4 p.m. You can schedule posts. I'm really awful at it. Generally, if you see a post on my page, I wrote it in the last half hour because I'm not that organized. But there are, with the business page, you can also get the analytics. You can see what posts do best, what posts don't. I never, ever look at them. I probably should. But
one other little point, too, I should point out quick. On your business page, you can actually filter who sees your post. When I got attacked by activists a year ago, I could go through and see where the most attacks were coming from, and they were coming from Australia.
The Australians are vicious.
So Australia no longer sees my feet. So just FYI. Any other questions?
Well, thank you.
We will be around too if you have any questions.